Now that we have classes and arrays, we can start to do more advanced designs. We've been using UML to simplify the design process. One of the big advantages of a tool like UML is that it makes it possible to think through what classes will look like and how they will relate to each other without actually programming them first. Changing designs before implementation is much easier than changing code after implementation. Once a class is programmed, it's very tempting to keep it, even when it's imperfect, rather than throw it out and start over. In fact, this happens in Java too. Check out the documentation for the date class in the java.util package. You'll see 4 constructors and 17 methods marked in big, bold letters as deprecated. Deprecation is a threat from the people that make Java that future versions of Java may not contain these methods and that you shouldn't use them, even though the methods are currently in Java and can be used. Now, I don't take this particular threat very seriously because these methods have been deprecated since Java version 1.1. This version of Java came out in 1997, not too long after some of you were born. So what happened to the date class? Well, the original date class had 3 main goals. It kept track of a particular millisecond of time. It allowed that particular millisecond of time to be interpreted as days, months, and years, and it interpreted and formatted dates as strings. That's too much work for one class. But there's a deeper problem. Java was designed to be used in software around the world. Just as different countries use different languages, calendars are also not completely standardized. By mixing together the millisecond in time and the Western Gregorian calendar interpretation of time as dates, the Java language was made unable to work with other kinds of calendars. And that wasn't going to cut it for a computer language whose founder correctly had international ambitions. Being international means giving every language, every culture, and every calendar the ability to be expressed. Java had not been out very long when this design error was discovered. New classes were created to break up this work into separate classes. Date still stores a millisecond of time. Gregorian calendar interprets that millisecond of time in years, days, months, and so on. And other classes interpret the date in other calendar systems, including Hebrew, Islamic, and Japanese imperial calendars. The work of interpreting and formatting dates as strings is done by date format. The valuable lesson here is that more than 15 years after the initial design mistake was made in the date class, it still infects Java programs. Why don't the owners of Java just remove the methods and be done with it? Well, that would break every program that had used the functions that are now in Gregorian calendar and date format. While every decent Java programmer knows how to fix this problem, the number of lines of code that would require maintenance is staggering. So the methods remain in Java. The lesson I want you to take from this is that design mistakes can last a very long time, so it pays to design carefully and thoughtfully. So, how do you design a larger program? Let's work through an example. Suppose we want to write Twitter. Wow, that sounds ambitious. Let's get a start and see how complicated it is. We may have to leave out some features. I start by identifying the classes that I'll use. Remember that classes are generally nouns. When I look at the Twitter interface, I see people first. That's one class that we will certainly need. I also see tweets. This is a noun, and hence it's likely to be another class. Our design now contains 2 classes. One of the great things about UML is that you don't have to show every detail in every diagram. It's okay just to use class names or class names and some data or to show everything. This is wonderful for design. Other nouns that are visible are followers and following. Both followers and following are arrays of people. Before we go too far forward, we should consider whether followers and following should be arrays of people inside the people class or whether they should be a separate class with a reference inside the people class. These 2 alternatives are shown in the design. Are there other alternatives? Well, absolutely. For example, our followers and following classes are looking awfully similar. Maybe they should just be one class that represents some group of people objects. Consider this design. We've recognized the similarity between followers and following by making both of these objects of class group. We now have 3 designs, and we could certainly come up with more. So here's one secret to being a good software designer. Consider lots of alternatives. I have a friend who's a professor of architecture. So while I'm teaching students how to design and build software, He's teaching students how to design and build buildings and spaces. There's similarities, believe it or not. He pointed out to me that architects have come to understand that when you describe a design project to an architect, the first four designs they do are pretty mundane. Designs 5 to 7 tend to be where the really creative and interesting solutions are. After 7 designs, the new designs tend to just be recombinations of old designs, and you don't get much new creativity. One of the biggest mistakes that new programmers make is to implement code too soon, instead of working on more creative and better designs. Now, you may be thinking that you need to get coding, since your project is due, and that's true, particularly if you put the project off until the last minute. But a good design will make coding so much easier that it's worth waiting for. You may be wondering which of our 3 designs is best. The truth is, we don't know just yet. Putting everything in one class certainly looks simple. There's nothing wrong with simplicity. But because we've been working with just one class for so long, it sometimes seems comfortable. And there is something wrong with letting one class do all the work if the program is non-trivial. When classes get too large, they're harder to understand, write, and maintain. By the way, Twitter is non-trivial. While the data in followers and following appears to be identical, are the whole classes really the same? Well, when you have followers, you send all of your tweets to them. And when you're following someone, all of their tweets get sent to you. These are very different things. So the only design that I would rule out immediately is the one where followers and following were both abstracted into group. These classes may have similar data, but they don't have the same function. So it looks like our second design is the best for now. But we don't want to throw away these other designs just yet. We can work on the second design and return to the other designs if we run into problems. Let's think a little more about the person class. People have names, a Twitter address that begins with an @, descriptors, a location, and a URL. You can see the data fields very well in the user interface. We translate these fields directly to UML. Immediately, there are some tough questions. Should the descriptors be a single string or an array of strings? Should the location contain a city and a state? Or should it just be a generic string? It is so easy to just slap string in there and move on, but resist that temptation. Slow down. Think it through carefully. When I'm designing, I leave 3 question marks in places where I need to carefully consider decisions, rather than just making quick choices. If I think I know the correct choice, but I'm not really sure, I put in the choice and I follow it by a single question mark. Of course, this is my system, and you may find other ways to design. The critical matter is not to make decisions without thinking them through carefully. So let's think about the descriptor. Why does Twitter have these descriptors? Is it possible to search by them? Now, I actually don't know the answer to this question on Twitter, so I'm going to think about what would be better, no matter what Twitter chose to do. What's the benefit of using an array list of strings or a single string? Well, suppose I was looking for another quilter to follow. Is it easier or faster to search an array list of strings or to use contains with a single string? Well, we learned something about the string objects earlier in the chapter that may help us out. If we interned our string objects, comparing 2 strings would just be comparing references. That is a very cheap operation. I know I told you that was advanced programming just a few days ago, but we've learned a lot since then. Of course, we still have to decide if we want an array or an array list of strings. The critical matter here is whether we can fix the size of the array. If we can, we should use an array. If we can't, an array list of strings may be a better choice. Well, in pretty much all online software like this, particularly free things, size limitations are well accepted. We can give our people a fixed number of descriptors. We'll just be sure to use a constant so we can fix this later if our choice is wrong. I put 4 descriptors in my profile, so let's allow 10. It'll be hard to fit more than that on the screen anyways. This design decision is shown in UML by removing the question marks from the descriptor and putting in a string array, and then adding a static constant that I called descriptor size. Remember that in UML, static members are constants. That it's in all caps tells you that it's a constant too. Now let's think through the location. Twitter is used by people all over the world. While city is a fairly universal term, not all countries have states, and we certainly don't want to assume that everyone is from the U.S. So it may be best to leave the location as a single string and let each person decide how they wish to represent their location. For example, I didn't put USA in my profile, although in retrospect, it might have been smarter to do so. I created my Twitter account to tweet assignment reminders to my students. All of my students are in Oklahoma, in the USA, or at least they used to be. Now let's flesh out a tweet. Tweets contain text and can contain other persons' IDs and hashtags. Twitter shows my most recent tweets on the interface, so it's clear that the person class is going to need to hold an array or an ArrayList of tweets. We might consider whether the tweet class should contain a reference to the person who generated the tweet. Since the person who tweeted is displayed when the tweet appears on other people's home pages, the tweet needs to have this field. Here's a preliminary design. There's still some question marks in the design. Do I want an array or an array list for the connections in each tweet? It seems reasonable to limit the number of connections that can be made in a single tweet. After all, tweets are limited to 140 characters, so limiting the connections is reasonable. Let's limit it to 5 connections and stick with the array. Hashtags should also be an array, but an array of what? Is this a separate class or just another string? Since Twitter keeps track of which hashtags are most popular, called trending, hashtags are not just another string. We found another class. Now obviously this design is getting much larger than the previous designs that we've done. If we want to keep going, we may end up with 15 or 20 classes in our design. That would be overwhelming. So now is the time to do one of the hardest and most important things that any programmer can do. We're going to control the scope of our project. We were overly ambitious when we set out to implement all of Twitter. So let's cut back on our design. Let's not worry about hashtags and connections for now. Let's ignore followers and following. And let's just let person objects tweet to themselves. We haven't handled multiple person objects just yet, and we should. Since we don't want to fix the number of people that can use our Twitter, we'll want to create a class that keeps track of all the people using Twitter. This class's data would contain an ArrayList of person, and I've called it accounts. Our simplified design is shown. This is now well within the range of what you should be able to program. We have the design for the classes and data, but we haven't chosen the methods. Just as we considered every class and data element, we would need to work through the methods with a fine-tooth comb, one method, one parameter, one operation at a time. I'll leave that part of the adventure for you to work on your own. You may want to compare your design to a friend's design and see how they are the same and different. Pick the best parts of both designs before you start to implement either one. And do not increase the scope of this project until you have a simple version working perfectly. Just like it took months to build up programming skills, it'll take time to build up design skills. And just like programming, there's no substitute for practice. No professional programmer creates programs without designing them first. And most professionals do design reviews, where they ask another programmer to look at their design and suggest changes before they implement any code. It takes discipline, but it's worth it. I consider design to be the most fun part of the whole programming process, since it's one of the most creative and challenging elements.